It's an event recorded in the Bible, and echoed in virtually every culture on the face of the earth. A memory of a time when the hand of God was stretched out, all but wiping mankind, and the beast that had been made along with him, from the face of the earth. In my last video, I addressed the question of how Noah was able to fit all of the animals onto the ark. And as part of that explanation, I pointed out that Noah was only required to bring the land vertebrates, which would only have numbered a few thousand or a few tens of thousands of animals at the very most. This meant that those animals would have nicely fit onto the ark as described in the Bible. But what about the animals that Noah didn't take on board the ark, namely the marine life and invertebrates? After all, the world of Noah's time was coming to an end. The massive supercontinent was breaking apart into the smaller continents that we see today. Massive volumes of subterranean water spewed from beneath the earth and into the sky. Volcanoes erupted and the skies grew dark. It was the most terrifying event this planet has ever witnessed. The wrath of God was literally being poured out. The oceans would have rushed in, consuming the land. And within weeks, all of the streams, rivers, and lakes would have been taken in by the rising floodwaters. But we know that many fish species are very sensitive to slight changes in their environment. Shockwaves likely killed fish by the millions at a time. And in particular, we know that freshwater fish usually cannot survive in salt water, and vice versa. So how could they have survived this epic deluge? And what of the insects and other invertebrates that Noah didn't bring on board? During the course of this video, my focus will obviously be on how freshwater fish could have survived the global flood. But as common sense will tell you, much of what I say here can apply to marine life in general, including seaweed, microbes that live in the water, and even the various reptiles and mammals that primarily live in the seas. I'll also touch on how land invertebrates and plants were able to survive the global flood, but those answers will be surprisingly simple. Also, keep in mind that this is a short video, not a full encyclopedia on apologetics. Sometimes I see posts in my comments section and really wonder if people understand the concept of a short video. A lot of people will want to split hairs, and often people will even want to debate me on points that are not even controversial. What I can do for those of you who have further questions about topics and points of contention not covered in this video is give you resources where you can learn more about these questions and find answers from scientists on the creation side of the creation-evolution debate. Those will be provided in the description box and at the end of this video. The pre-flood world. The first point to keep in mind is that the world of Noah's time was not the same as the world of today. According to the Bible, the Great Flood occurred about 1,600 years after God created the earth. At this time, all of the land was gathered to one place. The main body of land on the earth was a single massive supercontinent that we call Rodina. During the flood, this continent broke apart into the smaller continents that we see today. In fact, it was originally a creationist who proposed the idea that the continents were once a single giant landmass. Also, keep in mind that the sea of the pre-flood world would have been a very different place. A lot of animals lived in these waters that are no longer alive today. It's entirely possible that these waters were also shallower and less salty than what we see in the oceans of our time. Mountains were likewise probably not as high as the mountains of today, which helps answer the question of how the whole earth could have been covered in water. In the past, many creationists have traditionally proposed that the pre-flood world was also surrounded by a water canopy. But for both scientific and biblical reasons, this model has been set aside by most creation scientists. But the takeaway lesson is that the pre-flood world would have been very different from the world of today. The pre-flood animals. Besides the map and the environment of the pre-flood world being very different, it's also important to note that the plants and animals of the pre-flood world were very different, including the fish. The fish of this era would have been genetically superior to their counterparts of today. Since the time of the fall, the DNA of all living things on Earth has been breaking down. Fish, in their more genetically pristine state, would have had a lot of advantages over the fish of today. These fish would have been genetically hardier, meaning that they would have had the ability to adapt to changes in their environment to a greater degree than the fish of today. This means the changes that would kill today's fish might be shrugged off by the fish of Noah's time. Please don't misunderstand me on this one. These fish were still fish. They weren't about to jump out of the water and go fight crime, they weren't about to grant wishes, and they weren't going to go jump into a little ball and take on the Elite Four. These fish were still ordinary animals, but their DNA had not broken down to the extent that we see today. This still does not yet explain how freshwater fish could have survived the global flood, but it sets the backdrop and brings me to my next point. Colonizing freshwater lakes and streams. My personal view is that a lot of what we see in freshwater ecosystems today originated in the ocean. If we have a freshwater lake somewhat near the ocean, without any fish or vegetation, it would not be surprising to see living things from the ocean migrate upstream and colonize the lake. It's not unreasonable to postulate that in the time since the flood, fish from the ocean would have colonized today's freshwater lakes and streams. It's entirely possible that when fish were first created, many groups of fish had the genes to survive in both freshwater and saltwater environments. We can easily picture a group of fish that had the potential to survive in both environments, but over time lost the ability to survive in one or the other. Imagine a population of fish that lives in the ocean. At some point, a group of these fish colonize a freshwater lake. Over time, they become more specialized to their freshwater environment, while their counterparts in the ocean might have lost their ability to adapt to a freshwater environment. In other words, saltwater fish that already had the ability to survive in freshwater may have colonized freshwater lakes and streams. They may have then adapted to specialize in a freshwater environment and possibly lost their ability to survive in the saltwater environments that their ancestors originally came from. Their saltwater counterparts may have also experienced the opposite effect, losing their ability to adapt to a freshwater environment. As living things adapt to an environment, they can sometimes become over-specialized and lose their ability to adapt to other environments. A fish that could previously live in both freshwater and saltwater might lose the ability to survive in saltwater if it's been trapped in a lake for too many generations, or vice versa. This might occur in the form of losing the ability to regulate salt concentrations within the body, but that need not be the only possibility. Most fish orders actually contain species that live in freshwater and species that live in saltwater. Freshwater trout have been known to hybridize with salmon, which migrate from saltwater to freshwater. What I've read of these particular cases is that the offspring are sterile. But the fact that they can hybridize is a strong indicator that these two species once shared a common ancestor. From a creationist perspective, this common ancestor probably gave rise to a number of species that we see today in both freshwater and saltwater environments. Sticklebacks. In a previous video, I mentioned a group of small bony fish called sticklebacks. In a rather interesting turn of events, a species of saltwater sticklebacks colonized Loberg Lake in Alaska, and rapidly underwent major morphological changes. A new species of freshwater stickleback was observed to form in less than 20 years. Needless to say, this was beyond amazing, but I find it unfortunate that scientifically uneducated atheists, like Bill Nye, mock creationists for talking about rapid speciation. After all, rapid speciation is something that has been observed many times across several groups of animals. It's no secret to biologists, and were Bill Nye to open up a biology textbook, he would know this. A lot of people hailed the example of sticklebacks as some kind of affirmation of Darwin's theory, but they might be surprised to learn that in the example of sticklebacks, the speciation event occurred as a result of a loss of genetic information, not a gain of anything new. While a loss of genetic information can bring about an advantage, this is not the same thing as the gain of new information. which Neo-Darwinism requires to happen, at least on occasion, but which has never been observed. Haloclines. Probably the most counterintuitive possibility for how freshwater fish could have survived the global flood would be haloclines. Haloclines are layers that form in the ocean where you see different layers of salt concentration. So the layer on the top might be freshwater, and then there might be a layer below that that is seawater, and a layer below that that is very highly concentrated saltwater. Haloclines can be found near certain types of estuaries, places where freshwater rivers empty into the ocean. They don't always form. It depends on the estuary. But sometimes the freshwater will float on top of the saltwater, even for hundreds of miles out to sea. During the flood, it's been suggested that freshwater fish could have survived in a layer of freshwater towards the top of the ocean, while saltwater fish could have survived in the saltier layer below. This hypothesis is interesting, but still begs a lot of questions about the stability of a halocline environment along these lines. But it's certainly a legitimate possibility. But what we can say for certain is that environments like this are found in nature, and the rainfall during Noah's flood would have served to reinforce such an environment. Interestingly, there are videos on YouTube of underwater rivers that are very high in salt concentration. Perhaps this answers the question of how SpongeBob fills his bathtub. I once had a hostile commentator on my YouTube channel who wanted to debate me about this point. I explained to him that under the right conditions, freshwater will float on top of saltwater. The commentator then responded that this wasn't true, because, in his words, freshwater and saltwater are, quote, not immiscible. Of course, no one ever said that they were. But he clearly did not understand that freshwater and saltwater have different densities, or that haloclines are no secret to scientists, regardless of your views on creation versus evolution. This is why I always try to encourage my hostile viewers to keep an open mind. Just because someone's views are unorthodox doesn't mean that they are stupid or that they don't know what they're talking about. I myself have a strong science background, but unfortunately, most of my hostile viewers want to argue with me about points that are not even controversial. Floating debris islands. While haloclines might be the most counterintuitive explanation for how fish survived the global flood, floating islands of debris would clearly be the most exotic. During the flood, entire forests would have been destroyed. Trees would undoubtedly have been uprooted by the billions, people and animals would have been killed, and the obvious result would have been huge islands of floating log mats filled with carrion and debris from the pre-flood world. Similar phenomena still occur in the world today, though the picture isn't necessarily quite so gruesome. It's not hard to imagine seeds and insects surviving on these floating mats. Termite colonies would face a great deal of stress, but nothing that the colony couldn't easily handle. Likewise, hollow logs would become sanctuary for small invertebrate refugees. Seeds, insects, and small ecosystems would have survived the flood on these giant naturally occurring rafts. It's also important to note that seeds from animal carcasses have been shown to germinate even long after being in an animal's gut. Darwin himself did experiments along these lines. So, as gross as it might sound, corpses from birds, beasts, and even people that were entangled in the debris could very well have harbored seeds that later grew from the remains of the decay. Ironically, Darwin also did experiments floating snails on pieces of wood, and they did just fine. These floating islands would have also served another purpose. When waves hit the edge of these islands, some of the wave's energy would have been dissipated by the debris. This would have helped to prevent the upper layer of freshwater just below the mat, including freshwater from rain, from mixing with the salt water underneath. Basically, the islands would have reduced turbulence, helping to preserve a halocline underneath. Rain would provide a regular source of fresh water, helping to refill the supply of fresh water under the island of debris. If there were pre-flood fish that were less tolerant of salty conditions, then this could have helped to create a small sanctuary for them. This may have also provided a source of fresh water for land-dwelling invertebrates that lived on these floating islands. Obviously, this creates a lot of questions. The ability of these floating debris islands to preserve a small freshwater ecosystem depends on a lot of things. How big were the islands? How violent were the waves? How much freshwater in the form of rain fell on these islands? What volume of freshwater contributed to the rising flood from freshwater lakes and streams? Good science is about asking good questions and seeking answers. Even if someone doesn't believe the Bible and doesn't believe that Noah's flood was a real event, asking whether these are viable scenarios is still a legitimate question. With regards to the mixing of freshwater and saltwater during the flood, I've seen a few cases where uneducated evolutionists have claimed that if you mixed saltwater and freshwater, all of the animals in both environments would die off. While I agree that the overall conditions of the flood would have been devastating to aquatic life, the claim that nothing would have survived the mixing of salt and freshwater is definitely overstated. After all, there are fish and other aquatic organisms that can live in both freshwater and saltwater. Areas where rivers meet the ocean, called estuaries, are often teeming with vibrant ecosystems, far from the sterile environments imagined by these skeptics. There are lots of possibilities for how fish could have survived. It's important to remember that there are a lot of possibilities for how fish and aquatic life in general could have survived the Great Flood. I discussed several possibilities here, including post-flood speciation, the possibility of freshwater and saltwater layers, and the possibility that floating debris may have helped to stabilize these layers. It's also important to realize that these possibilities are definitely not mutually exclusive. All of these possible explanations may have contributed. We should also consider the fact that many marine and aquatic organisms that we see in the fossil record are no longer around today. For example, the fossil record contains many different species of trilobites, and they were probably once common. But as far as anyone knows, all trilobite species are extinct today. It's entirely possible that these animals were completely wiped out during the flood, and it's entirely possible that some of them survived, but were later unable to adapt to a changing world. We may never know for sure. It's also very possible that some fish and aquatic organisms were able to adapt and survive while others were not. What we see today may very well only be a small remnant of what once existed. I know that many of my viewers will have more questions than answers at the end of this video. I may not have covered some point that you really wanted covered, and that's okay. All I ask is that viewers be open-minded enough to hear views that they disagree with, and to seek out answers to their questions. Please, feel free to leave your questions in the comments section. This gives me the opportunity to come up with ideas for more videos. Also, I will include links in the description box to help you find answers to your questions, including a link to my website and a link to a creation search engine. Thanks for watching. Be sure to subscribe, comment, rate, and share with your friends on social media. And be sure to stop by often to see my new videos.